Something existing beside the institution that need to be formed in an institution, and this there is the instinct that goes to the institution. And the intentionality, in a sense, is the way that represents this direction from the instinct to the institution. And then the constitutive rule is this of ontology. It's a kind of, well, you see, a social object is a physical object that received a social function in a given context. By the way, this by construction is the social ontology you can find in Searle's theory of the construction of social reality and in the several works on collective intentionality, social ontology based on Searle's theory. And the action that is characteristic of this institution is the alienation. Alienation in two senses. There is an alienation of the intentionality of the leader. I alienated some of my right to the institution. And it's also the alienation in the sense that the instinct, the say anthropological basis is deformed by the institution. This is I said served by say also so the social contract that you saw is nothing different from this. Problems with this kind of construction, of institution by construction. First, it supposes a kind of perfection by the creator of the institution. I mean, the creator of the institution are full of power, and alienate some of their power in order to give rise to the institution, which is counterintuitive because it supposes a perfection of human nature that is without any proofs, in the sense, for instance, that human nature is free, is powerful, is meaningful, is intrinsically meaningful. All the kind of presuppositions you find in Rousseau, he says, man is born free and is everywhere in chains. Why so? I don't know. Second problem, which has been shown by many criticism of Searle's theory, is the object. It's not so easy to find the object that corresponds to institutions. For instance, you can say that it applies to social objects. For instance, you can say that a human body is a professor. But what about debt, for instance? What is the material presence of a debt? And, of course, it's very difficult to say that there is a solid basis of the institution, namely that, for instance, the leading of the government is not an institution. So this idea that X counts as Y and C does not apply to the institution. Another problem is collective intentionality. I believe that the idea of collective intentionality is chimeric. There is not such a thing like collective intentionality. And there is, I believe, no one that till now has given a single demonstration of the existence of the collective intentionality. That you ground an old theory on a basis which is pure imagination, the collective intentionality. In this sense, I do not deny that there are institutions by construction, but the constitutive rule of this institution by construction is the constitutive rule of the monster of social object. That I suggest to be object is an inscribed act. By object as an inscribed act, I mean that a social object is a result of a social act, namely an act that implies at least two partners, and which has the character of being inscribed in the mind of people, for instance, a promise, inscribed on paper, for instance, a contract, inscribed or an electronic device mostly happens today. This is the first type of institution I wanted to show. Not paradigmatic and not the more diffuse, because if we reflect the most of institutions are not of this kind. In my hypothesis, the most of existing institutions are institutions by promotions. The ground of this kind of institution is what I call the humanitarity, namely the fact that exist in the culture and in the archive and in the mind of people some documents recorded that speaks about this kind of institution. The direction is a reflection from an institution. By this I mean that we have not a purely free intentionality that creates an institution, but there is an intentionality which is in a sense articulated by the institution. For instance, imagine education. During the education training, the institution modifies our intentionality. And if I cannot imagine, for instance, a wild-born baby of the jungle that desired to be a commodore, imagine. Why you desire to be a commodore? Of course, you can desire to be a commodore only if you live in an institution that supposes the existence of admiral, commodores, professors, and so on. This makes that the instinct is not a primary data, but is the result of a very directive instinct and institution. And here, the constitutive rule is object is recorded act, which in a sense is a larger definition of the constitutive rule of the institution by construction. Because here, the object can be constructed by simple recording, namely the fact that we don't only formal documents. We don't need the explicit formal action. There is plenty of tacit, implicit, and formal act that gives rise to this institution. And the action that is supposed by this type of institution is the revelation. By revelation, I mean the fact which is strictly correlated to the dialectic between instinct and institution. By relation, I mean that the institution is not the alienation of unintentionality, a pure intentionality independent from the institution, but it's a revelation of the intentionality and of the nature of the human mind. The institution are much more revelation of what we are than alienation of our pure nature.
What 10 minutes do you wait for me?
Less than 10 minutes.
Less than 10 minutes. In this case, I will go fast. I skip this and I go directly to this. What I want is supposed to be, try to make it clear now is that first, the institution by construction is not the standard but a minor part of a larger quantity of institutions that are institutions by emergence. Those institutions by emergence are basically based on the rule object, in this case institution, is a recorded act. More specifically, a series of recorded acts. What I want to show now, and the hypothesis, the hypothesis of revelation, namely the fact that the institution is a revelation of human nature and not an alienation of human nature. Institution, not only the institution, but also the technique that is supposed to act in this institution as this kind of power revelation. And this is very important for the third kind of institution, the institution by globalization. The ground is what I want to call documentality, in the sense that now the situation is that there is no more a difference between a documental sphere, archives and documents in the standard sense, a media sphere, and a, so to speak, real world sphere. They are all in the same web, and so to speak, Carl Schmitt terms, we have land, sea, and recording is the web. In fact, there is this kind of diffusion that now is referred to the most of the world, to which there is this kind of institution by globalization that explains also discourses done yesterday, for instance, when Ugo Mattei was speaking about the fact that most of the power now is not a power of state and of formal institution, was referring to the fact that the most of power now is in the institution by globalization. Here, the direction is from the institution to the instinct. I mean, this power of revelation that lies into the institution became more and more high in the moment in which there is this extension of the institution by globalization. And I would say that in this sense, we can suppose a constitutive rule that sounds project equal recorded act. What means project equal recorded act? Means that exactly the opposite of the image of an intentionality that creates an institution. Here we discover that our in intentionality or project are determined by the institution. We are not the pure, spontaneous origin of our own intention. We are the result of the institution and the action is the mobilization. This is a phenomenological point I want to stress because to me is what is much more evident in our age, the fact that there is in act a mobilization of humanity because no equivalent in any other part of human history, and in my sense it depends from this institution by globalization. How this? I will try to suggest. The most popular device existing in this institution of globalization are devices of recording. These are devices of recording that creates growing responsibility. I believe that the most false definition of our age is the definition of our age in terms of liquidity. Modernity is not liquid. Modernity is an age of intense responsibility that depends on the fact that each act, each reaction is recorded and assumes a kind of intrinsic normativity. We are responsible for something which is recorded. But think about WhatsApp. When in WhatsApp you receive a message and then you have to say, I get this message. This is the origin of responsibility. And explain how high could be the weight of normativity and of responsibility that is intrinsic to this apparently informal institution. This kind of institution shows also the main character of human nature, which is not the freedom but subordination. What humanity is so disposable to be subordinated and shown by this device, because this is human nature. Also planification, of course, when you have all the little world that transformed for intentionality, the society is much more planified than before. And well, I will leave this point in order not to enlarge too much the field of discussion. But if you believe, you think, but what he is speaking about, this guy? Reflect what you do every day with your mobile phones and your email and your. You are mobilized, responsible, coordinated, and planifying, and this kind and this is a construction of the intentionality, much more than something constructed by the intentionality. And this is something that I believe it will characterize the more and more human life in the next century.
Thank you.
Yeah, then it's good down. It's a kind of normative.
The hypothesis I suggest is that
that is the reverse. There are institutions, place, format of living that creates passion. Imagine something like the romantic love, for instance, could exist without novels, movies, and something like the desire of winning a chess party could exist without the rules of chess. This was the first. Of course, this question goes on the second part of your concern. Because, of course, one can say, well, and if you build a lager, then you will be allowed to make a Shoah because I am a lager, so that I am obliged in a sense to make a Shoah. This is very important. It's something that was the third point that I skipped for reason of time, but the fact that we don't have a theory of morals, and I believe that we will never could have a pure theory of morals. We have only a history that shows example of actions, and we can decide among this kind of example what is the right example to choose. We are not obliged to do the worst or what happens. The category of exemplarity to me is very important because there is something which is intrinsically paradoxical in exemplarity, namely the fact that example is in the same time something very valid, if here and there an example of problem, and very normative and canonical. This is the bottom of the sea, this is the canon of the. And there is always the possibility that exemplarity create something new in history and with a moral value. When I put the exemplarity, I was thinking about this passage of Foucault in his pre-Postulus article, Course of the College of France, in which he was saying, as you know, Parresia, he says that what is curious in Parresia is that to tell the truth is something which in the same time is very canonical, very conformistic, very codified as action, but can have a disrupting action creating something new. And this was the reason of the interest of Foucault for Parresia, and I believe that this interest of Foucault for Parresia was precisely an attempt to answer your question, because for Foucault too there was the same problem. If you say that the noble, the power are the same, how can you criticize the power?
Okay, I think
that
we have time for. Thank you for your presentation. I was just curious to hear your opinion for which type of institution would you create the institution for human rights?
I'm sorry.
I'm speak louder.
I am an old man with a problem of acoustic problem. Not only acoustic, but.
Sorry, I'll try to speak louder. I was just curious to hear your opinion on which type of institution would you create. Institution of global human rights. For to me, it seems like we could say that it's an institution by construction, as it was, it is grounded in intentionality, given the foundational documents of the Declaration of the Human Rights. On the other hand, we could argue it is an institution by emergence, as it is an institution that has been built through the various documents of international legal, legal documents, and which, where then we can argue it's grounded in documentality. And on the other hand, it, we could also argue that it's an institution by globalization, because of this peculiar dynamic of global law, which is very important, and also by, what you said, the importance of being grounded in local mediality, because global human rights issues being mediated globally is something that's very constitutive for this institution. So I just want to hear your opinion on that.
Thank you. For me, the basis, the basic phenomenon is emergence and non-constructivism. But, of course, in the emergence, we can have construction. I mean, it's not because most of society is based on emergence that I cannot make a contract between me and you, for instance. This is, but the form, the contract. Intentionality, like the contract, are dependent on the emergence, much more than the contract. So, I would say that also to answer the first question on the first question, the two types of institution I described today are not mutually exclusive, of course, but are in a sense embedded. We hope that this is not a permanent market.
No.
No. So we have the globalization that includes the emergence.